What is up, YouTube? Welcome to the Legion of Comics. I'm Mark, and there's a huge, huge new comic book day coming up this week. I'm very excited for it. I'm excited to take a look at some of these titles, but before we do, check this out. Real quick, if you haven't already, hit that thumbs up, consider subscribing to the channel, and ring that notification bell. Creeping up on 850 subscribers. That 1K mark is within reach. I'm excited to get there. Got a lot of fun stuff planned. And I'm going to celebrate the 900 subscriber mark when we get there on the way to 1,000 subscribers. And if you haven't already, be sure to check out my secondary Instagram page, LOC Pops Attic. It's linked in the description below. If you're looking to buy any old comics or fill any holes in your runs, that's a great place to start. If you don't see anything directly on the page, feel free to reach out and you can message us directly on there, and we'll be happy to go diving through the back issues and see what we can find. All right, so let's get right into it. There's a ton of great stuff coming out this week. Very excited. A lot of stuff to read. Last week was kind of light. My hair's crazy. I know it's late. Ready for bed. But I wanted to go ahead and get this out and go through all these books. So first up, without wasting any more of your time, Detective Comics issue 1038 is coming out. And the saga of Mr. Worth continues. It's been such a cool character. I enjoyed that last issue. That old money versus old money story is going on right now. So it's about to be Bruce Wayne versus Mr. Worth battling over the fate of his daughter, Sarah, who died. We still don't know the details on how she died or who really killed her. We do have the backup Huntress story that's bled into the main story, where there's a lot of deaths happening all around Gotham. Some just not mattering to the people who are in power, and some are. But it's pretty cool having Huntress in there. It was cool how she came for Batman. Like, he was an actual suspect. She doesn't even trust him. And the backup story in this one's going to be featuring the Penguin. Not sure what's going to be going on with that or how it's going to be relevant. But they have done good with this title, bringing the backup stories into relevance with the main story in the book. And that main story of the book is brought to us by Mariko Tamaki. Either way, I've enjoyed Detective. It's definitely one that I don't realize how excited I am for it until I've actually read it and realize how good it continues to be each issue. It's just, I think, because not as many people will talk about it and go for it as they do the regular Bat title, but it's consistently been amazing. Next up, we have Action Comics issue 1032. And normally I am a strictly cover A guy because of that price difference and how many books I pick up. But this one reminds me of George Reeves, and I made sure to go ahead way early on and make sure I have this B cover waiting for me. I love that black and white color hold with the red and yellow S right there being the only color. It just looks like George Reeves from back in the day in the movie serials. But it's Action Comics 1032. This title is being brought to us by Philip Kennedy Johnson. We find Clark and Jonathan kind of starting the War World Rising storyline. And we have a bunch of refugees from War World that have showed up on Earth. And we're kind of discovering that they are familiar with ancient Kryptonian. And we're not sure if they are ancient Kryptonian or not. But the Superman family is trying to figure out how to proceed with it. And we're just going to be getting our bearings of those refugees kind of actually communicating with the super family and moving forward from there. And hopefully we'll get some more backup on the whole world situation, what's going on with Mongul, because we saw this mysterious character come and deliver all the heads of his kids to him two issues back. So I'm excited to see more from that character. I'm wondering who it is, why we didn't see him in that last issue. Are they going to appear in this one? So I'm watching very closely on this. Philip Kennedy Johnson's doing amazing things. I'm interested to see where they're going to go with Clark in this title. Next up, this might look familiar. It was on the list last week, but it got pushed back. And this is Brian Michael Bendis, Justice League number 63. And it looks like we're going to be wrapping up what was going on Naomi's homeworld and whatever dimension it was in, and coming back to Earth and kind of looking at this new team we have on the cover here. You see the formed Justice League for this book, looking at the two newest members, and Black Adam is even in shackles right there. So we're going to see if he's going to be integrated into the team and see where Naomi fits on this team as well and see what it looks like moving forward. This also includes the Justice League Dark backup story by Rom V. Now, this is what really sells me on this book right now. I wish it was its own book in its full size and everything. But we have Merlin, the Merlin. He's out and about causing havoc, wreaking havoc. He's seeking to raise the original lost city of Atlantis for what means we don't know. But he's on a warpath against all things magic. And it's just been really enjoyable. I wish there was more in each issue. I've been absolutely loving it. Next up, 2 in 1 week, we also get Superman issue number 32 by Philip Kennedy Johnson as well. So we've seen Clark and Jonathan off on this other planet battling these aliens. They went there on a distress call, and it looks like Superman has been overwhelmed, and it's up to Jonathan to save him this time. So what this book has really been spotlighting is that relationship between the two of them and how Jonathan's really coming into his own as that hero, as that man who can stand on his own, which is really pivotal for this title because he's going to be taking this title over. Philip Kennedy Johnson's time on this title is not going to be as long as it is with Action Comics, and Tom Taylor will be stepping in, and the title will be rebranded and renamed, and it'll strictly be Jonathan's title. So we're getting close to that happening. So we're seeing a lot of the story in this not necessarily being plot-driven, but everything that's happening, the action, everything's just background to what's going on between the relationship with Jonathan and Clark. So this one I'm watching closely at what Jonathan's been up to and what's being told to us about him in each of these issues. It's been really good as well. Next up, just pure guilty pleasure book. This one has been fantastic. This is Batman Superman issue number 19. And I got word from a good friend in the community today that he saw an announcement. This is going to end at issue 22, which is heartbreaking, but you know, it's going to end on a high note if that's true. And I'm really been excited and happy to read every issue of this. And this is a Gene Lung Yang's book right here. And Ivan Reis has been doing the art. He's one of my favorite interior artists in modern comics. He's consistent. He's amazing. It's in your face. It's fantastic. But we've had just kind of multi-world, multi-dimensional storytelling here. We have this Artura IO space deity that's able to control different realities in the form of film strips. So we're kind of hopping between them. And it looks like they're going to be playing with some of the genres now going forward, because obviously from the cover, you see they're going to be in the wild, wild west. So this is going to be really fun. I'm excited to see this continue to go. Next up, from Joshua Williamson, we have Robin number 3, and this is what's been going on with Damian Wayne. He's on Lazarus Island. That's right, Lazarus Island, like the Lazarus Pit, and battling in Mortal Kombat, for lack of a better word. The rules are you can die, but only 3 times. After the 3rd death, you lose your soul. You don't lose your life, but you lose your soul. And Connor Hawk, that second Green Arrow that came along after Ollie, he's on the island. He's the biggest opponent. It looks like they might be squaring off in this one. There's also a fantastic B cover for this. It's one of those negative space variants with Connor on the cover. And this is a fun book. I don't know if I'm going to continue to pick this one up in paper copy or just read it digitally. It's not necessarily needed in my collection, but it is fun. It's definitely a fun read. I'm not going to miss out on the story. I just don't necessarily know if it needs to take up space in my house anymore. I did finally drop Chris Cantwell's Iron Man, like I've been talking about for months and months. But so I'm trying to figure out what else I can drop, because there's a ton that I'm reading. Like Something is Killing the Children, issue number 17. This one I'm not dropping, but this is James Tynan's book, and it's continuing after that break. And we got that little, looks like we're going to continue to get the soft backstory to Erica Slaughter. We already knew her origin, but they're just kind of expanding it now. And that's really all there is to this. These books don't pack a lot of content in each issue. It takes its time. It tells the story slowly. But I am excited to see more about the dynamics of the House of Slaughter and the way that she was brought up through the ranks to become the monster fighter that we know her as. Next up, one that I'm really excited for, and this is Infinite Frontier, issue 1 of 6. Now, we were teased this with the Infinite Frontier, issue 0, that took us out of Future State and into the current era of DC Comics. It kind of told us stories all around the universe and all around the Omniverse. And this is supposed to be bringing some of those characters from the Omniverse together in an Infinite Inc. As in this team, you got President Superman, Alan Scott, you got Barry Allen, you got Rory back there, Obsidian, Jade. And they're apparently getting together because they know that they're back. All the events that happened in the past that were corrected, all the crises, all this and that, were undone. So there's a lot of mayhem that's being left in the Omniverse from that event of undoing everything. And they're there to go find friends, seek answers, this, that, and the other. And Darkseid, of course, is looming in the background. So I'm very excited about this. That cover is fantastic. Alan Scott's in there. I'm excited that we're getting some of the JSA coming. I feel like it's taking forever, but we were teasing that Stargirl. We were teasing Doomsday Clock. We were teasing Infinite Frontier. And now here he is in a 6-issue series. My favorite Green Lantern, Alan Scott's right there. So hopefully we'll start seeing more and more of them come in and get that full relaunch of the JSA by Geoff Johns here soon, which, man, I hope it happens. But I'm looking forward to this one. This is a floppy pickup for me. I'll be adding this to the pull list for sure. Next up, we have Teen Titans Academy, issue number 4. And this is being brought to us by Tim Sheridan. And this has been great so far. I've really enjoyed it. It has had that soft crisscross with the Suicide Squad title where the team was sent to go after Bolt and everything. But now that's over. Now the book is going to have to stand on its own. we were introduced to a whole new class coming into Titan's Tower. So now we have the original class, the upper class, and the lower class. The original class being Nightwing, Firestar, all of them. They're the teachers. And then there's a lot of characters. I got to be honest. There's a lot going on in here. I'm afraid it might get convoluted. We're going to find out. This is like the Bat Gang. They're all like three different characters that idolize Batman or something. I don't really know. I guess we'll get a full introduction to them in this issue. But they're out on the case to figure out who the Red X is. So I'm all in on this Red X thing, but I'm not necessarily all in on picking up this floppy anymore. I don't know if I need it. I definitely will continue to read it, but I'm kind of worried. I'm wondering if this book with so many characters, with so much stuff going on in one little area, if it'll be able to balance well, if it'll be a book that just screams, I need to buy it every week. I need to collect it. I need to own it. I'm not sure. I'm going to find out. Check back in with me next month and we'll see how this one goes, or check in with me next Sunday at 9 p.m. for At Week's End when we talk about it, spoil it. I'll probably have decided then if I'm going to continue to add these paper copies. I've already got kind of like the first three, you know, this will be my fourth one. So any kind of big hitters, any key appearances in the first few, those would be easy to reacquire down the harder to reacquire down the road. But just standard regular floppies that don't necessarily hold any inherent value, if I feel like I want to collect it and add it to the PC down the road, it would be easy to pick those up. So that's kind of the decision-making thoughts I'm going with. Now, this one I'm super excited about. I know, another Batman title, right? But it's Garth Ennis and Liam Sharp on another Batman title. It's a Black Label Batman title, and it's promising a new character. So self-contained story. Garth Ennis is fantastic. You know him from all kinds of books, such as Preacher. Liam Sharp is an amazing artist. He did that Justice League Snyder Cut cover A that came out here recently. He also did a cover for the Green Lantern 80th anniversary with Alan Scott on the cover. He's a fantastic artist. Love his stuff. And Garth Ennis is fantastic. So I'm really looking forward to this, despite it being just another Batman title. But there's apparently this new something in town that's killing all the villains and going after Batman's worst of the worst. So we're going to find out who it is together. Highly recommend checking this one out if you enjoy dark, moody, twisty, potentially violent reads. Next up, this is definitely a digital only read for me. It's Fantastic Four Life Story number 2 by Mark Russell. That first one wasn't bad. It didn't blow my mind or anything, but I love the Fantastic Four. I don't read anything of theirs currently. There's not a lot of Marvel stuff that really screams and speaks to me. I wish there were, so I reach for these miniseries and try to find that feeling inside of those. So I'm going to continue to read this just for the sheer love of the First Family, and I'm not collecting it. I don't feel like it's anything that holds inherent value. They are basically what-if stories. They kind of retell the origin of the Fantastic Four. Each issue is a different decade moving through the years, and they kind of change little things here and there. It deviates from the path. Like that first issue, Reed and Ben were never lifelong friends. They just got introduced by Johnny and other little things like that. But they're really fun. It wasn't bad. The artwork was decent. Next. Also from DC, it's a DC heavy week this week. I know it normally is for me, but this one's extra heavy. There's just not a lot coming out for Marvel, the indies that I'm picking up. But Checkmate number 1 of 6 is coming out. Now, this one, I am going to pick up the floppy of issue 1. I do believe there's this new character called Mr. King or something that's going to be premiering in this issue. I'm not 100% sure, but this new hodgepodge team, and I'm excited because we have the Question on there. Love the Question. We got the Green Arrow, so it looks like all that little mistrust and arguing in the Justice League might take him somewhere other than that team and take us to Checkmate, where they're being sent out to take out and dismantle Leviathan once and for all. We got Lois Lane on the team, Steve Trevor, Superman's making an appearance in this, and this book promises to have thousands of appearances, whatever that means. There's only 6 issues. How are they going to fit 1,000 appearances in there? But this is being brought to us by Brian Michael Bendis. So I am not anti-Bendis. I'm not a fanboy of his. I do enjoy his stuff. I don't have any problems with a lot of the stuff he does. I'm not going to try to sell you on his Superman run, but I did enjoy it. So we're going to see how this goes as well. It seems like he's getting put on a lot of team stuff here recently. He's on Justice League. Now they're giving him Checkmate, and he's promising thousands of characters. So let's see if he's going to get in over his head or if he can tell a good story in a limited amount of space. So we shall see. Next up, here's a big one. It's finally here. The Todd Father promised us that this will be the year of the Spawn. Well, this is it. Wednesday is the day. Spawn's universe finally dropped. So I've been picking up Spawn for the past few months just to make sure I'm read up and caught up before this all happens. And there are 4 or 5 different covers that'll be at every LCS. I'm sure there'll be tons of retailer exclusives all over the place. But the whole reason I wanted to get back involved in this is because Medieval Spawn will be getting his own title moving forward. You know, after Spawn's universe, we're going to be getting four individual ongoing Spawn titles with Spawn, Medieval Spawn, Gunslinger Spawn, and the Spawn Core, I believe, where you get a team, like a four-person Spawn team, and head up by Lady Spawn or Deadpool, female Deadpool Spawn, or whatever her name is. But Medieval Spawn's always been my favorite Spawn. Don't know why. Maybe because as a toy, he had that big shield, and it was the Spawn symbol as a shield. I don't know. He's just fantastic. He's awesome. So this will be the cover that I'll be chasing down. I think it's the B cover, but it's done by Campbell. It's gorgeous. It's beautiful. He is the man. So I'm looking forward to this a whole lot. So Todd McFarlane said that for all those people out there who've never had the opportunity to buy a Spawn number one, he's going to change that this year. So we will get Spawn's Universe number one and then followed by four individual Spawn issue number one titles. So I am looking forward to that. Not going to be picking up all four individuals. Probably get that Gunslinger and the Medieval Spawn and see if they can stand on their own or if it requires all four. That's a lot to really commit to adding to a pool list. Next up, from Ryan Parrott, we have Power Rangers issue number 8. So I've been waiting on this issue. I've been talking about it. This series has been treading water, but they're finally going to run into one of the Imperials. We've been building and building and building and not really building. It's kind of weird. Just standing still, not doing nothing, but every now and then mentioning, just so you know, we're supposed to be building to this epic confrontation against these Imperials. And this isn't the final countdown. This is just a confrontation. So I'm sure they're going to get their butts handed to them and barely get away with their life, but I'm excited to learn more about these Imperials. And this is supposed to give us a little bit more insight into that. Let's get into it. I can't wait to be excited about reading some Power Ranger books again. It's been weak sauce for the past 3 months, so I hope they change it with this issue. Next one, another one that I'm semi-excited about is Mr. Miracle number 2 of 6, and this is being brought to us by Brandon Easton. So that first issue established who Shiloh was, it established why he does what he does, and established where he is at in life. And right at the time of them establishing all of this, they throw a curveball. They blow up his apartment. And who is it? None other than Scott Free and Big Barda's daughter, that person. I don't believe that they named her, but there she is. She said that she belongs in the Mr. Miracle title. So it's a battle for the title. And I'm thinking this issue, he's supposed to go back to the very first Mr. Miracle, to Thaddeus himself, and go to seek some guidance. So I'm excited where this will go. I hope they give us more information on Scott and Barda themselves. I wouldn't mind Scott popping up. Love me some Mr. Miracle. And this series, it was well written. It was kind of heavy-handed in that first issue. They wasted a lot of real estate repeating themselves and driving home the same point. But overall, I did enjoy it. I'm still excited about it. I'm going to collect it. I'm going to continue with the Mr. Miracle collecting. But anyways, that's all that's on my guaranteed pull list. I know we're 17 minutes into this epic long, but there was a lot of stuff. So I'm going to burn through some other stuff coming out that you don't want to miss or definitely consider picking up. We have Amazing Spider-Man issue number 69, as well as Wonder Woman issue number 774. And then we have, for the Hellfire Gala tie-ins, Wolverine number 69, and then Darth Vader number 13 for the Bounty Hunter, War of the Bounty Hunter tie-ins, followed by Way of X number 3, Guardians of the Galaxy number 15, followed by Sword number 6, Captain Marvel number 29. We have Undiscovered Country number 13, TMNT number 118, Harley Quinn number 4, and Silk number 4. Heroes Return. So the Heroes Reborn has ended and is leading straight into Jason Aaron's Heroes Return. So that's continuing. That's good that they're returning, because the MCU or the Marvel 616 universe didn't really get fazed by them leaving. So it's cool that they're returning, because you couldn't tell they left unless you're reading that self-contained series. But anyways, Stray Dogs number 5, which I keep hearing fantastic things about. Shadecraft number 4, which has already been optioned. Homesick Pilots issue number 6. Gamma Flight number 1, spinning out of the pages of Immortal Hulk, the book that nobody asked for. I'm loving Immortal Hulk, and I hate that they're doing this because I want to read it, but I know I'm probably not going to need to. Wonder Woman Black and Gold issue number 1, because if we don't have another color hold comic coming out on the shelf, what are you doing, people? It does look gorgeous, though. I just don't think those are necessary. I mean, how many people really enjoy anthologies in black and white with a little limited color? It's a great chance just to make covers and stuff and sell covers, but such an odd thing to get on a craze where. Are these companies really making money off these things? Carnage Black, White, and Blood, Wolverine Black, White, and Blood, Batman Black and White, Wonder Woman Black and Gold, Superman Red and Blue. It's just getting excessive. Next, Bitterroot returns with issue number 14, and we have an Image number 1 called Vinyl, so be sure to check that one out. It looks kind of wicked there. I might see what it's all about myself, but we're going to wrap this up, because good God, this was a long one today, but I told y'all a lot of good stuff was coming out. I hope you made it to the end here. If you have, and you want to know what my number one pick for this week's going to be, head on over to the Comic Vets channel, hit that subscribe button, and every Sunday be on the lookout for Two Cool Guys, Two Hot Picks, where him and I both go over what our top pick is for the week and why you should consider picking it up. And also want to give a big thank you to the Augusta Book Exchange. Paul and Donna are the best. They're the keepers of my comics, the guardians of my pool box. They always make sure everything I'm looking for is safe and secure every week when I get there. We've done it. We made it to the end. If I missed anything on this list and you think I should be reading it, drop a comment below. Tell me to consider it, and we can talk about it on Sunday. Otherwise, let me know down there what you're picking up this week, what you're excited about, what you're not excited about, and why. And I hope you can all join me every Sunday night for At Week's End at 9 p.m. on this very channel, where we talk comics, spoil comics, and we talk all things pop culture. Let your friends know to come hang out, because fandom happens here. And Loki's been going on, so we'll definitely be talking Loki and more. So hope to see you guys there. Until next time, guys, as always, I'm Mark, but we are Legion.